Now that we have seen how structure can be utilized in a particle filter, we are ready to start looking at how SLAM can be addressed in this context. And the method that we are going to study is something known as fast SLAM, which was developed by Sebastian Truhn and co-workers at Stanford University. And these were the people actually who made the first driverless car, who managed to complete the DARPA Grand Challenge in 2005. That car did not, as far as I know, involve any fast SLAM. The main state estimation technique they used was actually an uncentered Kalman filter. But anyway, this is a very interesting solution to the SLAM problem. So first, some motivation for this. Why would we want to look at particle filters for solving SLAM? And one reason is that we talk about both online SLAM and the full SLAM problem. And we are going to see later that also solving the full SLAM problem has advantages. So in online SLAM, we only want to estimate the current position or pose of the robot and the map of landmarks. In the full SLAM problem, we want to estimate the full trajectory of the robot together with the map of landmarks. And FastSLAM is, in a sense, the only method that is able to combine both of these in one method because of the fundamental structure of a particle filter, how a particle filter always samples trajectories. You might forget about the trajectories. You typically do that, but in reality, it does sample a full trajectory. So in a sense, you have a solution to both those SLAM problems. And a second reason, which is related to the first reason, is that by means of a particle filter, you're able to exploit structures in the SLAM problem that the EKF was not able to exploit. Because there is a lot of structure in SLAM. The question is how to exploit those structures as well as possible. And in particular, one of the main research topics have been how can you avoid having to deal with the very large covariance matrices that you typically get in an EKF implementation. But we know that particle filters are also naturally very expensive. And we know that the higher the dimension is, the more particles you need. So we really need some kind of dimension reduction if you're going to use this. And our main tool for reducing the dimension is Raoblach visualization. So let us look at the state vector in SLAM. It consists of the pose and the map. And then our strategy is going to be to partition it so that the pose becomes the nonlinear part and the map becomes the linear part. Because, well, we know that the pose list is clearly nonlinear because we have the rotation, the possible orientation change of the robot. Now, you might argue that this is actually the only significant nonlinearity because beyond that, we just have XY position. And well, we have, of course, the observations of the map, which typically are in form of range and bearing measurements. But we know that when we have both range and bearing, we can use converted coordinates, which are, for example, like the data you got for the first graded assignment. So with these kind of techniques, it seems that the orientation is the only really nonlinear component. But for reasons that soon will be clear, we nevertheless include the whole pose in the nonlinear part of the Raoblach visualization. So how does this conform with the general Raoult-Blackwellization framework? So if you look at the process model for the landmarks, which is now the linear part, nothing is going to happen with them. It's part of the process, so we just have an identity matrix there, which clearly is a linear structure. And also, the evolution of the non-linear part has no impact on the landmarks in the standard parametrization of SLAM. But of course, the evolution of the pose is non-linear because of the orientation expressed by this compounding operator that I've introduced earlier. So in addition to the process model, we have a measurement model involving this Cartesian to polar conversion. And then we have a rotation matrix involving the orientation. But this rotation matrix is not a violation of linearity, because remember, we are conditioning on the non-linear part where this orientation is. So that is fine. This Cartesian polar conversion is problematic, but we can linearize it, or we can use converted coordinates. So this is also fine. It's not a big deal. So then we get to the main idea of FastSLAM, which, by the way, is an abbreviation for factored solution to SLAM. So the key idea here is to factorize the posterior of SLAM as much as possible. And to achieve that, we condition on the Bose trajectory. So what then can be shown, I'm going to show this again on the blackboard. It's a little bit complicated, though not very complicated. We see that if we condition on the Bose trajectory, then the remaining part of the posterior is a product of independent posteriors of all the landmarks. And this is why we want to condition on the full Pose trajectory and not simply on the orientation trajectory, because we need to condition on the full Pose trajectory to be able to get this factorization, which is much better than just splitting it up in a non-linear and a linear part. Because still that linear part could be huge involving all the landmarks, but now suddenly we are able to treat all the landmarks independently. How can we show this? Well, here is a sketch of the main ideas. We might assume that all the landmarks to begin with are independent. And what happens when we, in a particle filter, when we go from one time step to another time step, is that we just append a new state to the trajectory. We are never actually performing a Chapman-Kolmogorov integral. We are never really doing any marginalization. And as long as you don't marginalize, all these independence properties are retained. And the only thing then that could screw it up would be the measurement model. But in the measurement model, we also have a product of likelihoods from each of the landmarks. So the measurement model is also not going to screw up our conditional independence. So this is very nice, utilizing the key structures of the SLAM problem. So then we can start to talk about how we implement the particle filter for this. So we are going, of course, to need particles for the Pose trajectories. So every particle is a Pose trajectory. Of course, we might only keep the last state of the Pose trajectory, but that's what the particle really represents. These particles have some weights, and each particle must then have a Gaussian representation represented by an expectation M hat and a covariance matrix capital P for each of the landmarks. And we know that when we are going to do the estimation cycle, we have to, at least now, if we think in terms of a sequentially important sampling, resampling particle filter, then we are going to do, we're going to do prediction update of the landmarks, and then we're going to do a proposal of the pose, which will be just a prediction in an SAR filter, and then we're going to update the particle weights. So let us look at how these four tasks are being done. Predicting the landmarks, that's very simple. Nothing whatsoever happens there. So we just keep the conditional posterior that we had from the previous time step. But when we receive new measurements, we definitely get new information about the measurements. And to ensure that we can use Raoult-Block visualization, we have to linearize this measurement model, which is quite straightforward. You get a Jacobian matrix that is of the same form as you got in EKF SLAM. And then you get a new posterior of each landmark conditional on the pose trajectory, which of course is evaluated by a straightforward extended Kalman filter. So yeah, I mentioned that if you have a sequential importance resampling filter, then the proposal is the same as the prediction. In the FASTLAM literature, this is called FASTLAM 1.0. They also talk about something called FASTLAM 2.0, where they use a linearization of the optimal proposal density. But yeah, we should not look at that here. So when you use the SIR filter in FASTLAM 1.0, then the weight update becomes just a multiplication with the likelihood. And as I said, this likelihood, we can factorize this. And then you get integrals of the unknown landmarks for every landmark. So this landmark becomes sort of a nuisance variable that you have to integrate out to get the contributions to this likelihood. And all these integrals become, by means of the product identity, becomes Gaussians that are easy to evaluate. So then we have the weight update as well. And this is really all there is in a basic FASTLAM particle filter. Of course, one thing have not been mentioned yet, which is data association. And this is really a problematic issue for FASTLAM. But it's also actually used as one of the main arguments in favor of FASTLAM, because these particles can be used to explore different association hypotheses. If you include association hypotheses as part of the particle, the argument then is that the likelihoods of the particles will reflect how good the association hypotheses are. But as I said, it's not entirely unproblematic, and the reason is that you're going to end up in situations where because the particles have different pose samples, you're going to get into situations where you end up with different numbers of landmarks for the different particles. Or you're going to get into a situation, even if you have the same landmarks, where some particles manage to find good measurements for association and some don't. And this really raises the question of, can you then really compare the likelihoods when the different particles are going to have different numbers of landmarks? So there are rigorous ways of solving this problem. But then you have to go beyond FASTLAM. You could, for example, look at my paper from the IEEE Aerospace Conference in 2014, but these solutions are generally much more complicated than basic FastNum. So what is done in FastNum is a couple of somewhat heuristic techniques. They use, for example, this thing they call greedy mutual exclusion, where they arrange the observations and sequentially, and then they try to try to find for us the best matches between an observation and a landmark, and then they proceed among the landmarks that they have not yet managed to match. And you can also include probabilistic elements in this greedy mutual exclusion scheme. So I'm a bit ambivalent about FastNum, the way I'm somewhat ambivalent about particle filters in general. I think there are better ways to solve SLAM that have come to dominate the state of the art in the last decade, which we soon will look at. But I still think that FastNum and the particle filter approach to SLAM is very interesting because it really highlights some of the key structures that are of importance in SLAM.